to y'all today. Apparently, y'all are very interested in this topic. I had to do this show because, you know, economists are baffled. How is so much money going across the border? And another issue with that is I'm here in Austin, Texas, and I can tell you all my lovely experiences here. But first, if you're new to this channel, you don't know who I am or why you're even watching this, my name is Erica Williams of the Classy Client Blog, author of Smartphone Millionaire, How to Invest in People, Businesses, and Real Estate from the Palm of Your Hand. And also, I currently manage $1.9 million in assets from rental property to trucking and more to come. So I'm going to do this show from a grain and a perspective of a person who used to work in apartment management. A person who's from North Carolina, where I firsthand saw agriculture change. I've seen whole cities change. I've seen people literally abandon the city because, you know, they were no longer the dominant minority or majority in that city. And there's a lot of myths with it, right? Because I've worked with people who are illegal every day, 7 days a week. And I've worked with people who had a spouse who's undocumented. You know, it's not uncommon. So, first things first, let's get through some of these comments here. Y'all already in here cutting up, but I'm gonna put it up here and address some of these things. Sunshine Smile, of course, is going there, but I'm gonna start you here. These are some of the myths that need to be dispelled. And if you could here, could you drop in the comments what city and state you're in so I can kind of get a grain of if any of y'all are even dealing with this issue, because it's a very important issue. Now, first things first, I want to let you understand that anywhere from half to one third of people who are here illegally actually came here with a work visa or came here via the proper channels and just simply overstayed their visa. So a lot of people believe we're just over flooded with people just driving across the border like, hey, I'm over there. And that's actually not true. Now, yes, this article is talking about Hispanic Americans, Mexican Americans to be in particular, but it does mention some El Salvadorians and some other things in the article for very important reasons. Essentially, people from Mexico quit coming. If you send $100 to $500 a week home to your family in a country like Mexico, depending on where they live, of course, because there's Cabo to Cancun to North Veracruz to all kinds of places internally and on the edges that have different standards of living, you effectively seismically change that city, how it looks. And yes, there are many documentaries showing how MS-13 kind of grew and cartels grew because there were no men in those towns per se. But 9 times out of 10, what you have to understand is when you are committed to sending $100 to $500 home a week, it's life changing. And I'm using it as a point for y'all to understand that you too can save and invest $100 to $500 a week. This isn't some magical luxury reserved for those who are practicing group economics. Now let's talk a little bit more here, okay? First things first, someone's gonna say, Erica, they aren't paying taxes. This is absolutely incorrect. They are. They're paying anywhere from $90 to $140 billion a year in taxes. Now, you also forgot, on average, they pay 8% of their income to state and local taxes. Okay, some of y'all forgot they rent that house out from Joe Gary down the street. Joe Gary still pays property taxes on said house. Okay, they're paying for a truck or a vehicle in North Carolina. Guess what? They're paying sales tax and property tax on that vehicle. Okay, another thing, first thing first, my friend works at the tax office. I used to work in the tax office. Trust me, they are filing their taxes to get tax refunds. Yes. Now listen, now you may say, but listen, there's levels to this that I can break it down, but I'm not gonna go too deep in the weeds. ITIN numbers, a lot of people start businesses. There's a lot of ways right now that Australians are coming to America and getting credit cards, but you're gonna say, but Australians don't have a social security number. That's correct. They have an ITIN number, okay? And listen, let's not pretend like banks aren't in on this. Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Wachovia back in the day. When I was in North Carolina at East Carolina University, I remember on every Friday, and I would go cash my check. I got a paper check back in the day. And I would go and it'd be like 20 guys lined up with a paper check. And they'd go and the guy would help them and talk English to them, boom. And they'd want to cash the whole check. They didn't care if Bank of America took $10. They wanted the whole check. Give them a whole check. They get the whole check, boom, leave, boom, leave, boom, leave. And people would be like, well, why don't they just leave some of that money in their account? Well, eventually some of them did. And my friend who worked at that lovely Wells Fargo would get secured cards all the time. They put $500 or $1,000 down on. Building what? Credit. Now, I talked about this a long time ago on this channel, maybe 5 years ago, about how my friends worked at Wells Fargo. And it was such an interesting experience. But I can tell you right now, here in Texas, even 2-3 years ago, we had problems with the title companies where people would bring in bags of cash. And they'd be like, no, no, sir. We have to go convert that and pay it this way. Or you have to wire that to me. Or you have to do this way to me. Right? There's a whole system in San Antonio. Trust me. But even when I was at the auction, Ritchie Brothers auction in Houston, guys were huddled together, 2-3 guys, and looking around. And they go to the counter and cash, $10,000, $11,000, $12,000. Now, many people say, well, Erica, it's just group economics. There's some mysterious, magical bank lending them money. Their home country's lending them money. I get it. I've heard all the theories, all the stories, all the conversation. And I can tell you right now, it comes down to math. Let me tell you, the number one thing, I remember working at Papa John's. We'd be at the counter and Friday was Pizza Friday and they'd be coming in, they're like, you know, pepperoni in the sweet, the small, the sweet. And I'd be like, pineapple? Yes. So they'd be ordering, but that math, that counting would be on point. On point. Part of why we are in denial about immigrants and, you know, this mysterious group funding and it's just people are bad at math. Right now, you got people renting Jeep Wranglers and Dodge Chargers and Camaros and crap, paying $800 a month for a vehicle, then another $200 a month in insurance, and turning you and looking you directly in the eye and saying it's because of those immigrants, you know. That's why we're not winning. It's because of immigrants. I'm not even joking as when we were in Irving, Texas, and the whole apartment complex, as we rode around the scooters, checking it out, was full of old Toyota Camrys, used minivans. And you were like, everybody has the same as that car. It was a majority Indian complex, right? There was a computer company right down the street in this Irving location. And a lot of them lived in this complex. And guess what? Told their friends about the complex. And then told their friends about the complex. So again, 80 to 90% of the complex was actually Indian American. One of my friends laughed and said, think about that. Think about making $7,000 to $8,000 a month and you're driving an old Toyota Camry. I said, yeah, but imagine the fact that in a couple of years, you're going to be able to buy whatever you want. Houses, cars, whatever you want. Send your family over here for months at a time. It's called math. I know people are going to be in the chat booing me and boo, Erica, boo. It's simply math. 9 times out of 10, what you'll happen is you'll meet people in America who say, I shouldn't have to work this hard. You know, they're taking all the good jobs. I used to be able to just go in a factory, make $15 an hour, just show up and mindlessly work. And unfortunately, those days are not here anymore. And I apologize that your whole goal in life was to show up at a warehouse and make $15 an hour. I'm really sad about that. Now, I know you're probably watching Tone Talks and all these people talk to you about how they're just discriminating against you. But the numbers are the numbers. If you ain't married, if you ain't working together with multiple incomes, if you're not saving any money, you're in a hole. To this day, I have people visit this office who are from YouTube. And say, man, Erica, you drive a Ford Fiesta? Man, you ought to be driving like a Lamb, a Mercedes Benz, anything. I've had other business owners. I can literally show you about 20 people right now who are certified, bona fide millionaires. I can show you a couple that makes $400,000 a year doing nothing. I'm making fun of them. And all of them have old ass cars, paid off cars. Every time you start talking to them about cars, they go, girl, we can go do this. What we care about a car? Girl, we can go do that. Why we even care about a car? See, there's a definition of what looks rich and what is rich. There are people right now who are in there trying to do miracle math on how they can afford the next level car. Now, I'm going to tell you this. I was watching this guy the other day, and he came to talk to me about something. I was like, cool, cool, cool. And he had Carvana on the back. Now, I'm not knocking Carvana. Carvana came out of drive time. And y'all can check this, double check this on me. You can go look it up. The family who made Carvana also are the owners of Drive Time. Double check me in the chat. And stereotypically, not always true, not always, Carvana was made off of Drive Time because the people had bad credit. And they had to do huge down payments. But you could get the car delivered to your house, boo-boo. So here this guy is with this Mercedes-Benz and a Carvana sticker. Well, here comes his friend with a Drive Times, the little plaque that goes around your plates, and a Camaro. Now, first things first, I start talking to them like, hey, listen, if you want to invest in this property, you know, it's probably going to cost us about $50,000. It's going to put about another $20,000 to do these repairs. And they were like, oh, we ain't got that. We ain't got that. I said, well, how much do you got? About $20,000. I said, oh, you each got $20,000? No problem. We're going to make this work. No, between us, we got. Now I was like, but you're driving a Mercedes and you're driving a brand new Camaro and you're wearing the flyest, flashiest clothes. And I've been on your Instagram and you're stunting. We have a problem in America. It's financial. Let me tell you, there's 10 million Haitians right now in Haiti. If they would just let, and Obama almost did it and then changed his mind immediately, but that's another conversation for another day. They let 500,000 Haitians or 750,000 Haitians come in America. Within 3 years, Haiti would look like Miami, or parts of it would. Now, many of you are saying, oh, Erica, that's crazy. No, no, these people in Haiti are getting paid 40 cents an hour. So you've got a cousin or uncle sending $100 every week to Haiti. You pay your entire month's salary, right? So now you start sending $500. You were able to buy a home. You start sending $1,000 a week. You're able to do what? Unlimited, untold things. See, people keep wanting to get you this dream that everybody back from the home country saved all their nickels and dimes, and they sent it to America with the one guy. And that's why he's rich. Look at this article that I'm attaching in here. I told you guys 2 years ago that the federal government was trying to sequester Western Union to give them the names of the 30 million people, unique, it means not doubles, means unique names that were sending money to El Salvador, sending money to Honduras, and sending money to Mexico. 30 million, if 30 million people send $100 a week, I'm talking about, look, all I can afford to give you is $100. That's all I got. $100 a week. How much money is that? That's life changing. There are a segment of Venezuelans who've made it to Atlanta, many legally, many illegally. And think about the fact that this young man told us on our Uber driver, more than one, oh yeah, I send money to the country right above Venezuela. My sister lives near the border. She just get over there, get the money, come back, buy food and groceries, and that's how we make it. I said, well, how much are you sending your sister a week? Is it that bad? He said, well, I send about 200. You know, that's a really good money for them. Imagine that. Sending $200 a week, which is 800 bucks a month, is life-changing for his family in Venezuela. Life-changing. This is math, y'all. Now, many of you are going to say, well, Erica, you're in Texas, you know, you're leaning hard. I'm like, listen, you talk about people who bought $40,000 houses that aren't that great in San Antonio. It's about ownership. It's about owning things. Now, you may say, well, Erica, but listen, there are $35,000, $40,000 houses in Macon, Georgia. There are $35,000, $40,000 houses in Augusta, Georgia, Augusta, South Carolina, little nowhere towns all up and down South Carolina. But you know what you'll see? You'll see a brand new Mercedes-Benz or a Honda or a whatever or a Charger at an apartment complex when you could own a home. Don't try to school me on these numbers because I know them. I've talked about them for years. I tell you right now, if I lost everything today, you know what I'd do tomorrow? I would simply go over, get the bank account, get the LLC, right? Even if I had to deliver some food to get the money to get the LLC, then I'd start a service business. I would go round up other people to work for me and let them, hey man, hey, 80-20 man, you just go ahead and you go and I'll take the payment and we'll be good. Boom. They know money, baby. They may act like their English is rough, but they know money and they know somebody in the group knows some English. This is not a weird thing. This is called work. Work. Right now in Cleveland, the guy I requested to go cut my grass is asking me for $500. I said, man, you better go find the Hispanic, you know. He said, that is the Hispanics. You got 3 feet tall grass in the back. You got shrubs growing over the house. We're going to have to come back here and do real work. So yeah, people making fun of cutting grass. People making fun of fixing roofs and doors and lawns. And as soon as I have this conversation, somebody's going to say, well, Erica, I don't want to cut grass. I didn't say you had to cut grass. But I'm pretty sure you know a lot of young men who could get out there and work for you, right? Right now, my cousin is in Cumberland County. And he said he went to go check at the driver's school for me for drivers. Like, hey, do y'all have recommendations? Do y'all have a list? How do y'all, you know, what do? You know, how can we, you know, get on this, see who you got coming out of the driver school? Because they not only have a driver class, they have a research yourself class where you just recertify yourself. He said, hey, man, I got, you know, I got a bunch of black barbers. They knew, but I got some other guys over here getting research. You want their names too? And I said, a bunch of black barbers? What are you talking about? He said, yeah, a bunch of barbers. Like 25 of them came here for this round of class, which is about 6 weeks, if I'm not mistaken. I have to double check. And I said, well, what made them do all that? He said, think about it. COVID. See, now you had this one skill that determines and depends on people coming in and touching people and talking to people and being in front of the base. But then you have this other skill that can go all day and all night. You can drive all day and all night. We're having a problem of skill. We're having a dislocation of ability. We're having a conversation about math and work. Listen, I'm going to tell, let me just clarify. State of Texas, you can find this in the articles. What is the name of that newspaper? I'm going to try to find it, but you can Google it. They followed Hispanic children for 20 years in Texas. Because the theory was, hey, guess what? All these kids here, they're just going to grow up and they're become bankers and lawyers and doctors and nurses. A little bit of Bailey's in there. And it's going to be wonderful. And it'll be fine. And Texas numbers will be great. And we don't have to worry about baby boomers retiring because all these Hispanic kids will just take those places. Guess what they found after 20 years of research? Nope. Nope. Kids did exactly what their parents did, but better. What do they mean by that? They researched thousands of people who had cleaning companies. Now their children are doing cleaning companies, but bigger. They researched construction companies. God, dad was here illegally, son here. Son now has a construction company. Nope, daughter has this company, that, a bakery, a food, whatever. They 92% of every kid did exactly what their parents did. I can show you a whole family. Right now, my insurance company, one of my insurance companies, not both, but one of them, for one of my authorities, is a whole Latino family in California. They wore me down calling up here like, hey, we'll give you the better rate. Bling, 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 bling. We'll give you the better rate. Bling, bling, bling. We'll give you the better rate. And I said, well, dang, man. Hold on, Raphael. Jesus. I'm calling up. They did. They gave me the best rate. And they wore me down. And you know what? When I went on their family's website and their Google ads, they had the father working, the mother working, the grandma working. I don't know what she was doing. She was doing some kind of paperwork, but she was old. They had the young son working, the other daughter working, the other kid working. Everybody got their insurance license. I told y'all the story of my family. When the 80s came and it was rough, grandma was like, yo, we broke. Farming is busted. Everybody make a decision today. We've got to move. And what did everybody do? They did military, they became police officers, or they went and two of us became nurses. With a quick, fast, and a hurry. It was like, boom, boom. There was a moment where multiple kids was in a house and parents were going basic and parents were going downrange. Why is this important? Skills matter. Even if you don't value those skills, again, I told y'all, why is the middleman to millions course so important? Because there are millions of people who do not know how to fix anything. I'm serious. They don't want to cut the grass. They don't want to, like, literally, my friend said there was a man called him. He said, what's going on? There's a bird nest in my back, in my little, you know, little attic part. There's a bird nest and there's a possum underneath my house. And he thought the guy was joking. He's like, nah, man, I can't go out there. So this man, this whole man with kids and a wife, he went in his backyard, removed a bird nest, and also killed the possum. The man was upset he killed the possum. He's like, man, I thought you was going to trap it and take it somewhere. He was like, no, where you want me to take a possum? To what forest? It's possum. It'll keep coming back. He made, I think, $235 for that. But the story was hilarious. And I said, man, imagine that. Being in your own house and afraid to, like, get rid of a bird or a possum. There's a skill for everything, you guys. And there's nothing wrong with you being afraid of a bird and possum, but you're going to pay somebody who isn't. There's nothing wrong with saying, hey, Eric, I don't want to do tech. Okay, but you have to do something. See, here's the thing. People want to be paid to do nothing. They want to be paid to do data entry. Well, guess what data entry pays? $15 an hour, $17 an hour. You're not going to come from New York and Ohio and all these places and I'm going to work in an office. Doing what? I was a receptionist in New York. I made $25 an hour. Well, maybe down here you're going to make $12. Because we can replace you with a teenager that do that same level of job. Now, I don't know why people are so baffled. I don't know why economists are so surprised. It's called discipline. It's called, I'm going to put $100 a week away. I worked at Jason's Deli on the end of a line of 12 ladies from various countries, from Mexico to El Salvador to Honduras, to the really, really short lady was from Belize. She was from Belize. And so we're there and they talking, and they talking. And the one lady was saying, and this is a true story, y'all. This lady ain't get arrested because she's just not. She'd been at this place for 20 years. And I said, well, why ain't she a manager? And the guy goes, well, she's using somebody's name, Miss Tammy. I said, Miss Tammy. She said, yeah, you know, I saw some of my paycheck is Miss Tammy. This is a true story, y'all. It's terrible. And so I go, well, who's Miss Tammy? She said, well, honestly, Miss Tammy is a disabled woman in Iowa. So I'm talking to her and I'm like, well, what happened? They're like, well, yeah, a couple of years ago, the IRS came by, you know, realized that I've been paying taxes and doing her whole taxes as Tammy for 20 years. Tammy still gets her disability because they think they can't prove, you know, who's using Miss Tammy's information. I'm not ratting on Jason Deli, but Jason Deli knows what I'm talking about. But as I'm talking to her, and I'm like, man, that must be frustrating because you're not a manager, but you've been here the longest. You know everything. You're like the manager. And she said, oh, honey, it's fine. I have like two houses in Mexico. I have a house here. I have a this. I have a that. And as I'm talking to her, I realized, oh, okay. Well, that's crazy. Several people on the staff had multiple cars back in their home country, had multiple houses, sending good money home. And I didn't do the math then, but I do the math now. $200 to $500 a week, especially if you're living in a reduced income or you live in multiple people in a place, it ain't hurting you to send $200 to $500 home. I remember one guy worked at Jason's Deli during the daytime lunch rush. Then he went across the street and worked at this Brazilian steakhouse. Yes, he was Hispanic, working at a Brazilian steakhouse, whatever. He's working at a Brazilian steakhouse. And he was like, yeah, you know, that money, I sent it home to here. Well, the more I talked to him, he had amazing English. He could go do something else. I look outside, what is he driving? Old Toyota Camry. For sure. They're like, oh, he rich, girl. He rich. You should get with him. And they were hilarious. Now, again, he already told me he had a wife back in this country. So I was like, what? But there's something about discipline and hard work that we really have to have a conversation on, and math. If you're a man and saying people are stealing your $29,000 a year job, I got questions for you. Now, even prime example, when I lived in when I lived in Birmingham, Alabama, the bottom part, the Hoover, and you had the Vestavia Hills, they decided, you know, the police and city council, we're getting rid of the illegals. Now, if you drive up this really long hill, up this one road, up going from Hoover, from the mall over there, they have this one hill. And there's this apartment complex, and it was like deep. It was like 500-unit apartment complex. If I could go back and find it, I'd point it to y'all. And it was, parking lot was suspect. You know, ain't nobody white or black living over there. It's just Hispanic. They made that law. I kid you not. We drove. My mom was driving me to go to her base because I had to go back to the Red Cross and finish my stuff with the tornado aid and leave her, basically. And she drove by and it was gone. I mean, there was five cars left, y'all. This is a 500-unit apartment complex. There were like five abandoned on like bricks Toyota Camrys and Honda Civics in this parking lot of 500 units. It was like abandoned. It was creepy. They had police tape over there. I said, man, what happened? Did a gas leak happen? What happened? They go, no, they passed that law. You didn't see the news? I said, no, I didn't see the news. What law was this? They turned on the news while we're at the Red Cross Center volunteering, finishing up our paperwork. And sure enough, the next day at school, 1,200 kids were missing. Well, they weren't missing. Their parents picked it up that night and left. That was just one apartment complex. They had already reported there were three or four more like it. Gone. Ghost. Empty. Now, the Indian community in that Hoover Vestavia area was a little bit nervous too, because they had all been living at this one particular couple apartments down the street from those Indian, from the Hispanic people. And they walk to the headquarters of AT&T. And if anybody knows what I'm talking about in Hoover and Vestavia, let people know. But they walked in the mornings. Like, you drive your car, it'd be 20 people deep walking in the morning, going over there to the AT&T. The AT&T also had daycare inside of it, also had a pool inside of it, also had a gym inside of it. Anyway, what was different about that part of Hoover is they had whole plazas in Spanish. They had a whole grocery store. They had the local polo over there. And when those people disappeared, sadly, those plazas looked so empty. It was, I know, economically, those places probably aren't even open anymore. Or if they are, they've been changed to maybe a buy-low store or a different type of grocery store. It's raw, it's simple, it's math. If you're ever here in Austin, Texas, it's math. We have plazas here off Lamar in Spanish. It's math. And right now, some people I do business with are Hispanic, and I'm glad to do business with them because it's simple math. Do you have this much money to bring to the table? Can we work together? Can I get leads? Can I get work done with you? Yes, then I will. Alex Baker just did a video talking about how he won't hire any more Americans. And I kind of agree with him. I know why. It's an attitude of entitlement. You're in a changing economy and a changing market. You should be elevating your skills. You are not getting paid just to breathe. But we have this school system that's kind of ingrained in you that, hey, you're American. You're supposed to make money. You're supposed to drive the newest car. Hey, I work 40 hours a week. I should live here. No, that is incorrect. That is not math. That is feelings. And feelings will lie to you. But hey, don't you worry. I'm going to go here and check you guys' comments because I know they're probably all kind of special. You go ahead and hit me with all those little tongue talks. I know you are. All right, you guys, let's see. There's 290 people here. I really hope you guys are hitting the like button. Please don't be disrespectful to the channel by not hitting the like button. Okay, let's see what you got going on here. Let's see what we got here. There you go. Bloop, bloop, bloop. Thank you, Jose Bone. Listen, see, people hate this. People hate that. I lived in a neighborhood, and this is called, you can go look it up, Memes Drive. And in this neighborhood, it's nothing but older black retirees and Hispanic people, and they're starting to be pushed out for gentrification. But now they're building a soccer stadium around the corner, which is kind of crazy because you're pushing all the Hispanics out that neighborhood, but okay. in the neighborhood. We had one guy who had not one, not two, but three big old souped up Ford 250s. And his house was raggedy. I mean, just being honest, it was raggedy, but he had all these tools and equipment and crap, and he had the light on, he had the Ring doorbell, like, you're not gonna come rob him at night. And one day our neighbor was, we were just talking like, man, I wish he'd clean up on that corner. She said, oh honey, he owns a roofing company. I said, now look at his house and look at them trucks. Them trucks is new, they work trucks, but they new. And if you know, like I know, a Ford F-250 is about 35,000 plus. I know. You don't want to believe that people have an ingrained desire to take care of home and legacy. That's because some of y'all were raised just by your moms, but that's okay. Some people actually have a deep longing desire to be looked on as well. So, you know, that's all it is to it. What's up, Doug? Oh no, it jumped. It took away a bunch of my comments. People who know true poverty are grateful and know how to put money aside for generational wealth. These are facts. Imagine making $80,000 a year and saving $45,000. Think where you would be in 5 years. Honey. When I see people driving Range Rovers, I remember this guy came down from New York and North Carolina. He was nice. He was a hardworking guy. He was just ugly. I won't go deal with it. And he was working at my cousin's group home. And then he was also working at this other group home at night. So, I mean, like, morning and night, he was like, and he had a Range Rover. And we started talking to him. We're like, why'd you come down here from New York? He's like, man, y'all don't know how good y'all got it. I mean, the rent is cheap here. Man, I got two jobs. Man, I'm going to get a third job. I'm going to put all this money away and buy stuff. I'm going to buy these cheap old houses. I'm going to get my own group home. And I remember talking to this guy and kind of laughing. But think about that. That's how they come here to America. Like, y'all, this so cheap. Y'all not buying this? What y'all doing? This is cheap. What's going on? Again. Anyway. Let's see what I got. Let me tell you, every time I meet people, I remember one time I went to go meet this guy, and I had to show these bank statements. I'm gonna just say it that way. And he was like, I don't know why I thought you'd be driving a Mercedes, but you know, every black woman that do real estate drive a Mercedes. And I started laughing. I was like, nah, man, I'm good. I want to drive a truck or go for regular. Honey, to the wheels roll off. Let me tell you, one of the wealthiest men I've ever been on a date with, a couple dates, but you know, we just weren't compatible. Anyway, so I go on this date and I swear to y'all, he picked me up in one of those Mitsubishi Lancers, right? I used to have one in college. I was like, did this Negro just pick me up in a Mitsubishi Lancer? With the rims on it, okay? So like, what is this, Too Fast, Too Furious, 2002? So he picks me up, we go out, and we, you know, just different stuff. We go on different dates that were like cheap-ass dates, and I thought they were funny. And I didn't really care. I was having a good time. And later, I remember looking and being nosy. Yes, girl being nosy. And saw his LinkedIn profile, and saw one of his Instagram pictures. So old boy had a brand new... He had a brand new Mercedes at his house that he owned here in Austin, but he would take girls out in his Mitsubishi Lancer just to see how they act. You know, them former military dudes, they do too much. They do too much. But it was, yeah, people be flexing out here. Honey Carvana. Listen, I had a friend who has saved up all this money. He's just saving this money. He's single. He got no kid. He's just saving money. And then they were like, he was really seriously in stress, y'all, thinking, I really want to buy this Camaro. I really do. And they were like, well, you know, man, how much money you got saved? Are you nervous? He's like, well, I only got like $400,000 saved for retirement. It's just not enough. And this dude is like, oh my God. And they're like, well, dude, you're 35. You've been driving this paid off other car for a long time. I think it's okay if you get the Camaro. I think it's okay. I don't know, but he's like, I'm going to pay cash for it. I don't want to do a loan. People have different risk tolerance levels. And again, when you meet people who make really good money and store it, there's usually a reasoning behind it, but I'll leave that alone. Listen, I right now mentally cannot. Every time somebody shows me a Jeep Wrangler, if it is over 13 grand, I'm like, can I buy something for 9, 10? I just want to pay cash, right? Same thing I'm looking for the Toyota Tundra. I just could not. Should the U.S. government keep accepting Somalians? I mean, look at what happened to Minneapolis. So Stratus, let's have a conversation about that. This is perfect for you to do this. Americans have a very short attention span and mental capacity to learn history. So George W. Bush, Somalia used to be just fine, absolutely fine. Somalia was overfished by Japan. And it was a problem. They were fighting between the governments. They were arguing. But here's what the kicker that pushed the country over. They're overfished. That's a big industry for them. Japan's literally going right up to their country, digging in the waters and back out. Then you have Western Union. Well, it was a version of Western Union in Somalia and many African countries, even Libya. Well, George W. Bush decided, you guys, I don't know about that company. Now, before we, let's back that up a little bit. Western Union came to Somalia, Libya, Yemen, and a couple other places and said, hey, we want to put our business here. We want to be your biggest wire transfer person ever. Somalia, Libya, and also Yemen said, no, thank you. We already have a really big processing company. I'm not saying the company's name for various reasons. I don't want this to get tagged with like terrorism or anything. And so guess what George Bush did? Because guess what? Western Union is a big dog in America. And I'm pretty sure they got enough lobbyists to push some dollars. Immediately, a month after they said no, George Bush signed a bill that went through Congress that said, hey, that's a terrorism organization. That Western Union light is funding terrorism. We're going to close them all down. You can't wire any money to Somalia or Yemen from America anymore via that channel. Well, guess what happened? All of a sudden, now you had to overfishing. Now you have the cousins who can't send you $100 or $300 bucks anymore a week. Guess what? Now you start having Somalia pirates who never attacked American ships, only Japanese ships. And then the Somalians that you do have coming here, guess what happened? They come to America and they get the wake-up call that you look black in the middle of Minnesota. So they're not hiring your sons. They're not letting you come work at places. You can only work at the factory. Yeah, they're a little bit angry in Minneapolis, just a little bit. So if you want to talk about the Somalians, make sure you do your history and retrack back, because financially, when they're not in Minnesota, they're doing pretty well. Matthew. The study shows that not everybody sent home money. Not every single person in Mexico is getting that rain sugar money. There's only certain people in certain towns getting that rain sugar money. So it's not the whole population of Mexico getting that money, by no means. There are certain towns and cities that are getting $100 to $300 to $500 a week. Western Union is doing a wonderful job of tracking every single dollar, every single dime, and you best better believe it. I remember one time I went to buy two cars at one time, and I had a conversation with my friend. They said, baby, you live in an apartment. What the fuck you need with two cars? The way she said it, this little white schoolgirl said it to me, it cracked me up. Because it's true. See, you'll go to an apartment complex. I just left that last apartment complex. You got Mercedes Benz, you got $70,000 Ford Raptor trucks, you got all kind of luxury cars. But the people that would move in and out of the community to move and buy their home had really boring cars. Saw it all the time. Here we go. Every other race has got reparations except for us. Ma'am, what if they don't give reparations for another 70 years? Let me be very clear. The reason I was so hyped up the other day in the video about 1989 and Wilmington Massacre is they finally won the lawsuit about 30 years ago that they had to pay the descendants who left Wilmington, North Carolina in 1898. 30 years ago, 100 years after it happened, they knew the names, the faces, the homes they burned, the bodies that were thrown in Cape Fear River. They know every freaking name. But guess what? It took them 100 years to give them the money. So you're going to tell me you're going to waste all your life on this earth fighting for what is owed to you. Now, listen, it's an honorable thing to fight what's owed to you. But what's more honorable is to stand up and take care of your family and the children you bring on this earth by doing the right thing. But that's my two cents. Boom, there you go. Boom, independent thinker. Paid off 2002 car in my garage, which I just pulled out money out to invest in a business. Oh, Chris McDonald, this is no lie. Yeah, right now, Aggie Land, what you'll notice when you come here to Texas, when I worked at Lowe's, you had a lot of Hispanic people who get mad if somebody would come and make them speak Spanish because they'd be like, he can speak English. And would like be mad, suck their teeth and be like, oh, I'm not. Like, we had a guy on staff, his name was Jorge. He'd get mad, he'd like, call me George. And I'm like, your badge says, okay, George. So then George is a manager, can't talk smack to him because he's a manager. So then anytime somebody would like, oh, I don't speak any English, we'd go get Jorge, okay, George. George was very cowboy boots, Texas, went to Aggie A&M. He'd come over there, sashay his butt over there, and the guy start talking to him, and he just would immediately start speaking English, and the guy starts speaking English back. He would never speak another lick of Spanish. And we would be like, well, George, he said he speaks Spanish. He could speak English. He just didn't want to. You have that attitude big down here. Now, I remember my New York friend who is half, I forgot what kind of Hispanic, but it's half and half black from the Bronx. And he came down here and he was so mad because he's like, these Spanish, these Mexican people, I think they white. And I said, why? What's wrong? They don't want to speak Spanish to you? He's like, no, they don't want to speak Spanish to me. I'm like, well, just because they look Mexican, they might not be Mexican, you know? And we had to have this conversation, but I was like, listen, they see people coming here not wanting to get along. But it's very Texan history that you have people that if you say, oh, you're Mexican, they get a little like, hey, I'm a Texan. You're like, my bad. Excuse me. So when people sit here and try to play like everybody's struggling and doing cutting grass, no, not really. A lot of these people have gotten education. Their children are doing well. This is true. This is all true. But most, if not 92%, according to the article in Texas, are now doing the exact same thing their parents did, just better. Whole family cleaning, whole family. Possum whisper, y'all still silly. Listen, people don't know how to fix stuff in their own house. People don't know how to cut grass. People don't know how to do a lot of things. Like, I'm not even surprised anymore. Possums are creepy. Listen, I do not even vacuum and clean my own car. I pay this guy to come over here and he charged me $70. He cleaned it out. He made that car smell great. Last time he used Fabuloso, I told him it was too much. And so now he switched over to something better. It don't smell so bad. Hey, pay for what you need, baby. Listen, if I could tell people that all day, I would. Them office jobs, them government jobs where y'all ain't gonna do nothing all day, even the post office, that's a wrap. Thank you, Doug. Lorna Road, yes, yes. Yes, thank you. Look at y'all. I love it. See, listen, this is why I love the Classy Climb Network. Somebody came and helped me out in Cleveland. Somebody helped me out in Detroit. Somebody helped me out in North Carolina. I've got a person hopefully help me out here soon. Y'all be doing it. Thank you. Thank you all of y'all. Lorna Road, that is where I'm talking about. It's a Walmart now. See, I knew they couldn't. Listen, it was a Hispanic grocery store, and I knew when their people left, it was a wrap. Highway 31, Hoover, Alabama. Thank you. Appreciate you. Listen, London Thomas, when Alabama made that rule, literally 3 weeks later, farmers were on the news like, oh my God, the crops are rotting on the ground. Nobody wants to come work for $9 an hour. And I'm like, y'all wanted this law so bad. Now y'all crying. Y'all need to pay people $10 an hour to come out there. They got to get their car all the way out of Birmingham. And let's be 100, they didn't want to hire black people to go out in the fields, and black people did not want to go out there. Now, I'm going to just tell you, North Carolina, some of our family friends, when they would hire convicts and they would hire actual Hispanic people, when the convicts, these are people who already got out of jail, got a felony, would find out they were paying the same amount of money as the migrant workers to work, they would quit. They'd be like, nah, I love that, and quit. How are you, who is a felon, think you're elevated past this when y'all both out here picking cabbages, when y'all both out here picking watermelons, when y'all both out here doing the same thing, throwing them up in this truck? Are you for real? Trust me, Americans have the worst sense of entitlement, and I don't mind you feeling entitled as long as you work hard for it. If you gonna work two jobs, I don't care if it's Forex. If you want to Forex all day and night and you make your money, make your money. But don't talk. It's insane when people are out here like, they're not paying living wages. Do you have living wages skill? Every person that works, Erica, should have a living wage. They should live in a roof. And I'm like, when I hear some of these people, I go, yeah, there's an apartment for you. It's a $400 apartment over there. It's going to be in the hood, but that's where you need to be because that's all your paycheck pays you. Oh, what's that book about? Okay, listen. I'm going to tell you what the triple threat is. Save your money. Don't buy cars. Buy a house. I talked to this guy the other day, and I talked about buying 40 acres here in Texas. And he was like, for what? For what? I was like, you've lived in Texas for five generations. None of your family own a house. You don't own a home. Your parents don't own a home. Your grandparents used to own a home. Then y'all sold it in Houston. And you asking me for what? That's gross. Your mama rented a house. Your daddy rented a house. You rented a house. Y'all don't own nothing but cars. Ugh, gross. Thank you for the super chats. Thank you. This thing is popping and moving. It's just cutting out people's comments, so I missed it. Why do I talk so fast? Listen, man. I listen. You know, I don't talk too fast. Tell your brain speed up, baby. He just was. I didn't laugh. Boom. Look at that. Look at that. Listen, here's the crazy part. People are like, oh, we can't push STEM jobs because they're giving all the STEM jobs. Honey, this is a lie. They are short right now at Facebook 1,800 jobs in this one particular trade that you can actually learn from the internet. But what happens is people get burned out in 2 years. So they hire Americans, Americans quit in 2 years, and then they have to keep hiring people from China. You're going to say, but they're not paying a living wage. They're paying $90,000 a year for one skill. And your favorite president, Donald Trump, already stopped the H-B visas for next year. So what more do you want people to do? You want them to just close the border so that people will finally get off their ass and get a degree and stuff that matters. Uh-oh. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to check out. I'm going to look for the email. This is facts. Listen, he was too fast, too furious in that Lancer, y'all. I guess they did. There's 303 people here. I hope y'all hit the like button. Listen, I could start a roofing company right now from right now, this desk. You know why? Because you don't need nothing to have no roofing company. You just need a hammer and a ladder. You don't believe me? Go look up what it takes to get a roofing company in Texas. They have whole commercials like, don't trust those guys that fly by night with a sticker on their truck. You need a certified roofer. There is no thing as a certified roofer. Go look it up. And this is why people be sitting here talking about, they got served. They come here with skills. Anybody can be a roofer. Even Texas changed the plumbing laws. If you work underneath a plumber for 100 hours, I think it's 100 hours, you can legally go out and say tomorrow that you're a plumber. Y'all think I'm joking. They're so short on people in these trades. Kendra, what you send me an email for? You better send it to my staff. What you need? That part. Context is everything. People love giving you these stats. Even like when I used to listen to Ben Shapiro, I loved it because he would give numbers, which would make people mad. He'd be like, well, that's not actually true. And then people would be like, they'd be mad. They'd be like, how dare you? It's the truth. Listen, you got it. Mr. Fantastic got the whole point of this whole video. Y'all up here, America owes me. Shit, America's feeding all kind of countries. Exactly, Dominic Griffin. They don't know the origin stories of anything, but they'd be like, look how they acting. Flash Wave, you better cry. You better cry right now because you will never get another tenant that will pay on time for 5 years. Never. Never. Listen, the feds aren't playing with Western Union. They are not playing with Western Union. Western Union is going to give up these names. Western Union is like, we can't give up these names of these people because it's not right. And I know they're doing the right thing by not giving up these names. But how long is that going to play out with the government? Not long. Not long at all. That long, listen. I'm not even gonna talk about it. when somebody says doing the right thing, if you have children or a family or a mother that you don't take care of, the reason we used to have mental health hospitals in America, and we would lock people up who had nobody to take care of them. We would lock them up, put them in these places that were horrible. And that's what we would do as a society. When we started defunding them in the 50s under John Kennedy, some of y'all don't know your history. Then, of course, Nixon came. And then also, you also had Ronald Reagan really just close it all the way out. You had all these people go back into their communities. Private facilities could not handle all that. So when we talk about doing the right thing, I talk about the context of anybody who's in your family, under your guard and protection and conversation, that's on you, baby. That's on you. See, what people really love socialism right now, because if you really want to go 100% capitalism, we wouldn't let disabled children in the schools. They'd have to go to a different school. We wouldn't cover it with taxpayer dollars. We wouldn't have equal sports. We'd have maybe a lot of boy sports or maybe one or two girl sports. We wouldn't there's a lot of things we would revert back to if we're honest. See, people like socialism. They like it so much. They're like, oh, I got to take care of myself and my family. Yes. The point of me talking about those mental health places is the government really thought people would absorb them in the community and take care of their own family members and make sure they were on medication. No, that's not how that goes. That's doing the right thing, but I'll leave that alone. Listen, people ask me why I went into trucking. Honey, when I really got a peek behind the curtain and saw how every other community is just eating off trucking, and black folks are just driving the trucks and white guys are just driving the trucks. There's some white men who own the trucks too, but a lot of them just driving the trucks. They don't even think about it no more. You know, they just come out of Oklahoma driving, or Louisiana driving, Florida driving. They don't think about it. But when I start digging behind the curtain, the guy who is your broker, your freight owner, your shipper, your person controlling your insurance companies is not you. That's domination of industries. And if you don't own anything, you will listen. If the 30,000 Sikh Indians that are in trucking from 2017 to 2018, if they ever, in about 2 or 3 years, all rise up in unison and all buy one or two trucks, honey, it'll be a wrap. They just literally get people from India to be in those trucks and call it a day. You won't even see what black guys driving trucks, what white guys driving trucks. There won't be any. India has 1 billion people, and they have massive poverty. Imagine if you had 60,000 trucks here who needed a driver who wouldn't complain. Where would you get them? Not getting them from Mexico. You're going to get them from India. See, y'all don't understand the larger game that's being played in front of your eyes, and you're like, oh, I don't care about owning stuff. I'm like, okay, you about to be in a country where you don't get to do nothing. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you for the $5 super chat. Oh, Kendra. Oh, for sure. Listen, we've talked about on this channel, The Color of Law. We've talked about all these books. But when I sit here and have an honest conversation with you, what have you done the past 5 years? See, no one wants to address what you as a person is contributing to you, your economy, your society, the past 5 years. If I ask you, what you've been doing since 2012? What you've been doing since 2015? Have you tried to get approved to buy a house? Have you been approved to start a business? Have you bought land anywhere? Have you bought any kind of machinery, equipment? No. I'm just doing me. I'm doing what's for me. I'm just at my apartment with my fancy stuff and my vacations. I'm just living my life. Then I don't want to hear about it. I'm just done hearing about it, honestly. I mean, and I get why other people are done hearing about it from us too. Okay, well, what you been doing the past 2 years? Okay, what you been doing the past 3 years? Now listen, every time I bring up Bank of America, Wells Fargo, getting massive lawsuits over and over again for unfair housing and lending and business funding, I bring it up every time. But Erica, you didn't bring up I bring it up every time. Walk around it. Go around it. Listen, I can tell you right now, mortgage lender, Matt, don't take my word for it. Go ask Matthew, the mortgage guy. He says 9 times out of 10, when they go to look to see if they're going to give you a mortgage, they see if you've already bought the big body car. What is the big body car? The Mercedes, the BMW, the whatever, the fancy car. Why? Because they know from 2008 recession, you will leave that house and keep that car. They learn from the last recession. If you already got the fancy car, you ain't really serious about this mortgage. You ain't serious about it. And a lot of people get turned down because debt to income ratio, but really because they already had the big body car. They got the big body car, they got the student loan debt, and now they want to get a house. It's like, no, you did it backwards. But we'll have that conversation another day. Oh, Houston's a whole different animal. Houston's a whole different animal. Listen, he's telling you. Chris McDonald said he was born and raised in Houston. You have not met that hardcore white Mexican multi-generational TAMU UT types here. I'm telling you. They ain't even playing. They really not. Tex-Mex to the Mex, man. Chicano Texans, yeah. Listen, I want people to fight the good fight. Let me tell you something. I want somebody out there fighting a good fight. When I see Native Americans at the water, I'm like, yes, fight for it, honey. Fight. Fight for the water. Fight for that. Yeah, fight for the. We need soldiers in different categories of America. I'm not going to dispute that. But when you have 80% of your people focusing on this and not sliding up the ranks, it's just called a pipeline. The same thing's happening right now with Cambodians and Vietnamese and Laos. Massive gun violence, lots of gun shooting in California and Stockton and what's that other place in California? They shooting. They have a group of Asians that you keep calling minority. They have the same problems. Y'all act like when people don't get to America, they have a problem. They have fighting problems. They have gun problems. This is an American thing. But other people go, time to move up, time to grow up, time to slide up. You know, only a select group of people think, yeah, I'm gonna be a player, pimp, baller till I'm 50. Then when I'm 50 years old, I'm gonna get serious about getting a career, and then I'm gonna get a wife. Baby, you about dead. Average black dude died at 67. What you doing? You got about 17 more years. You can't cram 50 years of life into 17 years. No. Baby, listen to me. I want y'all to be very clear. Are Native Americans owed their money? Yes. Are black people owed their money? Yes. Will there be people fighting for years for this money? Yes. But what are you going to do for the next 5 years in your life? I'm so serious. I'm just so serious. Like, I don't care if somebody's homeless in the middle of Mississippi right now. What can we do to move that person forward over the next 5 years? Do we just say, nah, man, your life is over. Live in a tent for the rest of your life till you die. Is that what we do here as Americans? Is that American culture? Because I drive by homeless people with cell phones. I mean, again, go watch Invisible People. They show you so many people who are homeless, and yet they'll do Uber Eats. They'll deliver food. They're trying to get back into the matrix. Because if not, what else is there to do? Just drink and lay in the street and die. Go read the book Eugene Robinson, Abandoned Club. Eugene Robinson, The Disintegration of Black America. It don't just apply to Black Americans. It applies to all Americans. The abandoned class in America and the underemployed used to be able to go work in a factory, and that was okay. And again, if we give those people $1 million tomorrow, their life will not improve. And I know you don't believe that. Give them their money. You stop counting that man money. Yeah, but if in 3 years we have the same amount of people in squander and homelessness and terrible conditions, they're going to be like, we gave you your check. What you talking about? Gave you that check. You already got your check. See, your mind, as a man, think if he is. I think y'all really think I'm a horrible person, but I'm really serious. This has been tested a million times over. When they saw, they had a, you can go look this up for yourself. I ain't making this up. They have a whole documentary on Netflix on it, where they had people, the lawyer that was really famous for getting reparations for farmers, black farmers. If you could go prove your grandparents had a farm and lost their farm, you just write on this piece of paper, or you said you were in farming, you got $50,000 straight up, no lie. And they were making fun in the documentary because people had this $50,000 check, and you know what they did? They went out in Mississippi and Alabama and Louisiana, and they bought Cadillacs. I'm not shitting you. This isn't even a joke. They bought, you only got $50,000. That's all you got, 50. That's it, 50, make a big difference. 10 kids in a family, 50 people, 50, you know, 10 people with 50K each. Cadillacs, clothes. Should you not, go look this documentary up, it'll blow your damn mind. They gave, I think, $350 million or something for the black farmers, and then they gave $150 million for the Native American farmers. Same thing, the Native American folks, shit, crap cars, crap stuff. This isn't just black people. This is when people are in a poverty state. They are, as their mind thinks, as they will do. Go look it up. It's a whole documentary on it. It'll blow your mind and break your heart. Break your freaking heart. Mississippi, what are you doing to Cadillac? For what? Y'all, I can't even make this stuff up. Erica, doesn't matter. Give them a check. Okay, give them a check. Okay, cool. Same people that are rich now will be rich 3 years from now. That's good. I don't care. Jay Green. And my argument, too, is for that. For the 1980s and 1990s, could those black men have not got other jobs? Could they not have got other skills? Could they not have gotten insurance and banking and nurses and medical techs and everything else that's out there? Just a conversation piece. Listen, I've talked about this multiple times. College will only be for very extremely wealthy kids, and trades will be for everybody else. I mean, even as a joke, there is like a massive pride in the whole manosphere of like, I'm a man in an apartment just by my damn self. Yeah, me and my dog. Yeah. I'm like, all right. Good luck with that. Baby, you got 2 more seconds of conversation, and I'm just going to block you. How about that? I mean, we've already discussed what you had to say. We've already discussed what you've had to say, and I get it. You're upset, but guess what, baby? Go get your own show and talk about it every day. Every day, go on your own channel and talk about every day how they owe you some money. Let's see, oh man, y'all got this thing. There's 339 people here. Make sure y'all hit that like button. Don't come on this channel and not appreciate the channel. If you're enjoying the information that has been given to you, can you go ahead and drop a like? Can you support the channel just by a like? I'm not asking for a lot. I'm not asking for y'all to do anything you don't need to normally do. I'm just asking for a like. That's all I'm saying. I'm asking for a like. That's all. I mean, right now I'm sitting at 190 likes and 6 dislikes. I ain't asking for a lot. I really am not. I don't think I asked y'all a lot here. Now let's see what y'all talk about here. I'm gonna go back in here now. This is thank you. There we go. Part of the reason they were able to push it the last way through to defund a lot of them is President Kennedy's sister was mistreated at the hospital. She was what we probably would call bipolar or moody girl. And they did a lobotomy on her, and she lived to be 80 years old. She almost outlived all the other Kennedys. So did she need to have that done to her? Probably not. She just needed some meds to calm down. And back then they could put you in a mental hospital for just about anything. If you're a woman, I'm not going to read this off, but if you go read this, go Google it. The reason they put women in mental health hospitals. y'all would be shocked at some of the answers. That's all I'm gonna say. Do y'all want this to keep going? Listen, if y'all want this chat to keep going, put a one in the comments, and I'm gonna go get the extension cord and plug this computer up. Give me a one right now. All this heat I'm bringing is killing my computer. Okay, well, I guess my computer's like, we're gonna die. We done with you today. Let's see what we got here. I'm gonna come back in here. Let's see what you got. We're gonna roll our sleeves up and have this conversation, because I know y'all think I ignore what y'all say, but I like reading your commentary. This is facts. Yep. Jails are now the biggest mental health hospitals. Yep. What? Look at this person. Stop messing with me. You got to be able to know. You got to, like, when something doesn't look right, you got to say, do I need to keep going back into history and digging and figure out why doesn't this look right? What happened? And y'all stop playing with me. There's 232 likes. Let's get these likes up, man. Come on now. I ain't asking for nothing. I ain't asking for nothing but a like. I ain't even asking for dollars or money or pesos. Come on now. This is true. Listen, I'm telling you, when I went to go buy a truck one time, I walked up to these guys. I thought they were the ones they wanted me to speak to, but it was these two older black guys over here, and they were nice, and I spoke, but I thought it was these two younger black people. I walked up to them, started trying to talk to them, and they were like, we were from Antigua. I'm like, okay, what's up? It's the difference, but there's a difference. I promise you, people in every other country know what's up, but okay. Listen, people call me hostile all the time. It's crazy. Honey, the same things. Listen, let's do this real quick, easy math. People are shocked that, oh man, they got all these low paying jobs. How they get sending all this money home to Mexico? You can start a business and make more money, make $500,000 a week. I really want to drive y'all over there on Lamar Road. If you're anybody here in Austin, Texas, you know what I'm talking about. And they got like 12 food trailers in front of the flea market. That flea market is called a secondary market. And Glenn and Cameron probably can speak on this. There are millions of dollars moving in that secondary market. This is why they can't never get rid of cash in America. They claim they're going to get rid of cash and do all this stuff. Man, these Hispanic people and these immigrants are using cash. Count it. Okay. And every time I drive by on the weekend, these little Hispanic food trucks, they be running out of food. I'll be over there like, I just want like the little sugary thing, the churro. And they be like, we out, baby. I'm sorry. It'd be like 1 o'clock. They ran out at noon. There's money being made. People just got to decide how they want to do it. Now, on the flip side, you making $90,000 a year. If you like some of my friends who's driving old Hondas, it's a nice Honda, but it was an older Honda. She was driving 2006 Honda, and she making $162,000 a year. Like, old girl was like, what do I do with my money? She was looking for places to put her money. My other friend's driving an old 2010, what was that thing? It wasn't a Honda, it was an Acura, some crazy crap. It was with a Lexus car. It's like the Lexus car, but not a Lexus. Anyway. And they were looking for places to put their money. So if over the course of 10 years, you make $40,000 a year, average African-American person makes $40,000 a year, something like that. You know, listen to Tongue Talks. You know, we just all don't make no money. So anyway, 40K a year times 10 years, that's 400,000. Your friend in Texas making 90K a year over 10 years, that's $900,000. They are $500,000 ahead of you. Even if their mama and daddy didn't have no money, because I know three of them who parents are poor as a joke. No disrespect, but I know their parents. They pull up. $500,000 more than you across 10 years is a different life if you invest, or you just smart. You're just smart enough not to go buy a bunch of crap. It's a whole different life, man. Whole different life. Listen, I love seeing people from Atlanta do their little YouTube videos and they be in a 500 square foot apartment with granite countertops. I live in Midtown. Okay. You live in Atlanta, baby, where shit used to be cheap. Come on, man. And people say I'm dramatic on here, but I'm dramatic because I'm sad. I'm sad that y'all don't have any kind of fire in your belly. In your belly. Listen, Maya J, I bought on Jehenna to the channel. She came straight out of the Air Force. No school yet, making 130K, 130,000 a year. When I sit here and argue with y'all like, yo, go get your LinkedIn, go put your LinkedIn up. People, recruiters every day are on LinkedIn trying to give you jobs. And people be like, what LinkedIn? Instead of specializing in Facebook, you better specialize in LinkedIn. The average Social Security check is $800. If y'all is concerned about that, I'm a little nauseous to the stomach hearing that. Girl, people be thinking they gonna cram 50 years of life into 50 to 65. Go read some, listen, there are people on the internet telling you to not date or marry women. They got a whole wife and family in their house. There's one black dude who loves talking smack. He got a black wife with three kids. You never see the pictures of them, but I seen them. You know how I seen them? Because I'm in YouTube levels where we be talking crap. Like, man, you see his wife? Yeah, I seen his wife. Come on, man. They sitting here eating good in the hood, living delicious. Dinners in DeSoto, Texas, wife cooking, children going to the private school in that part of Texas, and telling you, no, brother, don't you get no wife. Don't you, you just save all your money till you 50, then get you a 20-year-old. I get it. It sounds lovely. It sounds like a miracle dream life. Tell that to your 30-something-year-old self now, because when you're 50, and your back is 50, and your parts are 50, and your head is 50, and your body is 50, and your mind and your hands. It ain't the same. It ain't the same. I used to do this thing where I would look at somebody's hand. When somebody would shake my hand, I would look at it. You know, I would look at it. I would look at their hand, right? Because my grandpa used to tell me, look at a man's hand. You know, we got to see what's going on with it, okay? And there's a whole story with that. But I would shake this man's hand one time. I was like, well, he looked good. I shook his hand. His hand looked like a 70-year-old man's hand. After you start talking a while, I'm like, oh my God, you're 49? Got that dog. Age like wine, but damn, sir, you old. Now look, you can have any kind of life you want in America. Don't let Erica Williams tell you you can't have a mythical, magical, you know, rare life in America. You can do it. But I want you to understand what you're telling. You're telling me you want to shove a bunch of life into the later years where you are not, I mean, I go say the words other people say, where you're not at the same level peak performance as other years. That's all. And here's the thing. My friends who have done tech and got out of tech, because I have some friends who've done that, who did tech for 10 years and they just got out of tech by one dude is investing in rentals. He just wanted to do real estate. He didn't want to do it anymore. he don't even do that much rentals. He has like four. But see, when you start moving that money to create a different life for you, okay, you got four rentals, your bills are low. It's a different life. You got a paid off car, different life. See, people really don't understand, you know, 5-10 years of hard work versus 40 years of working coasting. And I wanted to do this video later this week called The End of Coasting. It's the end of coasting in America, but I don't know how to set it up how I want yet. Oh, that immigration class. I actually took the immigration class offline because I didn't want people thinking I was some type of way about it, but I took it offline. It really does, man. Listen, people spend their whole life mad at the game instead of learning the rules and winning and playing and learning. It's like the whole mindset. Glenn Garrison says all the time, learn the rules so you gotta win. Did you see Miss M. Sway? Did you see the documentary I'm talking about? Where it's a white lawyer. He's got a ponytail, brown hair. He got a split in the middle. He got a ponytail, and he is famous. He's a famous lawyer now. Because basically, when you're a lawyer, you want to see a lawyer. Nobody even cares about you. But when you win a big, big lawsuit, that's when you become the lawyer. Okay. So now he won this thing for the African Americans first, right? He was like. Then he went over and won it for the Native Americans. Same results, two different, completely different people. Go. If M. Sway knows the documentary I'm talking about, it's a white man, brown hair, ponytail. He is famous for going to Mississippi, Alabama, getting them $50,000 checks for farmer disadvantage. What is it? It's like a farmer's reparations check. For the government basically not giving you loans and stealing your land. Really could. If anybody know what a documentary called, help me out. He said, I know a lady who lives in a two-bedroom apartment with TVs in every room, including the kitchen and bathroom. But see, TVs are cheap now. You can get TVs for nothing. It's funny, man. Listen, Dominic Griffin, tell him I'm a 23-year-old truck driver. I don't know how many times I've heard some old black dudes say I'm smart because at my age, they were chasing women and wish they got in the industry at my age. I'm telling you, people tell you them stories every day of the week, man, every day of the week. The boat party is still a go. We're good to go. We even sold some more tickets this past weekend. You will be just fine. Come on to Austin. Enjoy yourself. That's right. Man of Tomorrow cracks me up. He's good people. They do party now. Don't get it twisted. They do have parties on the weekends. But, yeah. Yes, Douglas, this is very true. I'm 35 and had 20-year-old girlfriends. All of them had problems. It's called They Just Got Out of High School. Yeah, you got problems. You want to party and get twisted and crump. That's what it's called. Yes, this is true. Marilyn Monroe was basically there for being difficult. I know, but Midtown looks so nice. Crime in Midtown and Buckhead is bad now. Is it bad, like murder crime, or is it somebody broke in somebody's car because they too lazy to lock the door? Because when I go look at people's PD stats, which you could actually look up public record, police reports in certain areas, 9 times out of 10, when I look up areas that are a little bit wealthy, it's a lot of opportunity crime. And when I mean opportunity crime, I mean something's in somebody's car, they break in the car, steal the stuff out the car. Yeah. Oh, this happens all the time. How, been the bartender? How is somebody stealing sanitizer? Hold on, y'all. We got it. Call me back, bro. Chill out. Thank you, Allie, for sending the cash app. Thank you for the $2 super chat. I appreciate it. I shook a surgeon's hand. It was like butter. But TRT, tell me what that is. TRT, explain it to the audience. That's funny. I'm just messing with y'all and y'all letting me cut up in here. Yes, women's necks and hands. I never, it's like, I look at men's hands and feet, like especially here in Austin, there's a lot of water activities where you can go paddleboarding, go get on a boat. I remember this guy, he was buff. And then I looked down at his feet and his feet looked like my damn grandpa's feet. And I was like, oh my God, how old are you out here with this trickeration? Maya J, I actually disagree with that. I've been to DeSoto several times, but literally, if you go look at the excellence, black excellence list, Richmond, Texas, DeSoto, Texas, Richmond, what's that other place? That other place was on it. Several cities in Texas are on it. And some people are like, oh, that's the hood. And I'm like, well, we're not according to these lists. Damn! Herbert Scott, boy. Y'all are wow. I know I've been on here about 1 hour and 30 minutes. It's time to go. Y'all doing too much, but you know what? I'm not even joking. I actually shook somebody's hand and was just like, oh, baby. Yep, I saw the documentary. It all happened during the Obama administration. If anybody can help me with the name of that documentary, let me know. They shooting up Buckhead. What? Where did that happen? Oh, where is it at? Is this here? Pigford versus Glickman. $1 billion. Listen. But that's not the documentary. I know that's the case. But I need the documentary. Because it also, the documentary showed it went to their kids, because 9 times out of 10 people's parents had died, right? People's grandparents had died, their parents had died. And all you had to write on a piece of paper was, yeah, that was my parent. And then they would give it to all the kids. And these are people with 10 kids in a family. So imagine, you know, in theory, we gave each kid 50K. So all of them together could buy back the land that was stole from them. And I'm not even gonna go too far. I'm gonna let y'all, Oh my goodness. And I've seen men with that. Oh Lord, don't do it, honey. Be looking like. Thank you. Thank you, Nick Taylor. People always want to say something's the hood. Come on now. I've been to New York and that's the hood. I would say neck and hands. You're right. Neck and hands. Been. He was right. Herbert Scott is right. Hands and neck is about on right. That big open place where you went out to East. Which place, Nick Taylor? Anyway, which place, Nick Taylor? Nick Taylor, you need to come visit my new spot, my Texas Ground Zero location. I got something coming, going good. But anyways, that's all I have for y'all today. I didn't want to be here too long cutting up. I just want y'all to understand that, you know, if you can consistently put 100 or 500 a week away to something, that's amazing. Now you may say, well, Erica, they working these jobs and they working, you know, fast food and all stuff. It's not even that. It's also the entrepreneurial thing on the weekend. My friend's mom had a flea market store, several of them, Korean moms, you know, black military husband or white military husband. And when we were in college, they were getting $100,000 American Express credit cards where their moms had put them on as authorized users and they didn't even know it. And I think what people don't understand is it's just math. It's seriously math. And just consistency, math and consistency, right? So again, go look at Mobile Home Elite. They got 17 rental properties. They got all kind of stuff, you know, and people don't understand where it's just small little habits you build up daily in systems will get you to freedom. So again, just like these people are putting away billions of dollars holding up Mexico. You guys, it's a lot of opportunity out here. That's all I got to say for tonight. I didn't want to keep going on it hard, but oh, okay. Somebody said this is the Pig Ford documentary. I'm going to take your word on it. I'm going to go look it up. I can't remember, but if you go check it out, give me some feedback on it. Okay, you guys. So look, this has been Erica, the Classy Kind Blog. Thank you for coming to the channel today. Thank you for watching this. I hope you're inspired to either go check out the course Middleman to Millions, or you're inspired to go invest and start your own thing, because guess what? Calvary isn't coming. All right, you guys. So have an amazing night.